Welcome to the Produce Moms Podcast, where we believe there is a produce mom in all of us. I'm Lori Taylor, founder and CEO of the Produce Moms. For 10 years, I sold fresh produce to over 300 grocery stores in the U.S. And today, my team and I are fully focused on inspiring people to eat more fruits and vegetables. This show is just one of the ways that we hope to inspire you and your family to eat more produce and live a better life. If you like what you're hearing on the podcast, join our community of almost 40,000 in all 50 states and over 30 countries by visiting theproducemoms.com/subscribe. And be sure to subscribe and leave us a review on iTunes. Thanks for being here. Enjoy today's show. Welcome back, everyone. This is the Produce Moms Podcast. And oh my goodness, we have a great show for you today. We are talking about Sweet Tango apples, and we have just truly enjoyed supporting the growers of Sweet Tango and working with Jen Parkhill, the executive director of Sweet Tango Apples, on some really great campaigns over the last couple seasons. And if you are not familiar with the Sweet Tango apple, first, we got to fix that right now, today. We got to get that on your grocery list and go buy it. But it's truly an apple that's known for this big crunch, bigger taste, fun flavor, very crispy. It's got this wonderful texture. And so many people, once they've had it, they're like, wow, now I understand the hype. And so it's a lot of fun to have this episode today and welcome Jen Parkhill to the show. She was actually part of our Thanksgiving segment last year. And we did have a podcast episode number 168 in the archives. You can find an episode with one of the growers of Sweet Tango. But goodness, Jen, we are glad you're here. Welcome to the Produce Moms Podcast.
Yeah, Lori, thanks for having me. I'm happy to be here. So,
oh, thank you. We're glad you're here. So please tell us a little bit more about yourself, your professional background, and any introductory remarks you have for our listeners today.
Yeah, I kind of grew up in the industry. My dad was a farmer in Colorado, and he grew corn and sugar beets. So, you know, I'm an old farm girl at heart. So I lived in the West, Colorado, Nevada, most of my life. I worked for U.S. Foods for about 19 years in marketing and produce category management, and kind of led me down this path to the next big thing and the co-op that grows the Minnesca trees that actually produce the Sweet Tango apple. And I've been here for about 2 years now, and just couldn't be happier to represent a better product and a wonderful group of growers who just are amazing within themselves.
Yeah, isn't that the truth? The growers are what make, you know, I mean, it's what makes the industry what it is, in my opinion. I mean, their hard work, their resiliency, their optimistic attitudes, their risk-taking every single day. I mean, just I have said it many times, but farmers are the ultimate risk-takers. And it's been a pleasure to get to know so many of the growers of Sweet Tango. And like I said, Jen, we had that wonderful episode 168 where we really got the grower's perspective on Sweet Tango apples. But I'm interested in getting yours. Like, explain, what is this variety, how long it's been around, where it's grown. I think your grower network is definitely a point of differentiation between Sweet Tango and so many of the other brands of the produce department.
Yeah. So Sweet Tango was actually developed by the horticultural research team at the University of Minnesota. It's a cross between a Honeycrisp and a Zestar. David Bedford and the team at the University of Minnesota have a great research program, and out of it has come, you know, some wonderful varieties, and, you know, Honeycrisp, and most special to my heart, the Sweet Tango. A lot of people don't understand that apple commercialization takes a very long time for it. It's really kind of the ultimate in product R&D. So this variety, it's usually about 20 to 30 years from start to finish to planting and crossing that first initial graft, and then getting an apple into market. So, you know, when you say you've got a lot of blood, sweat, and tears into this apple or any kind of, you know, apple development, it's really the truth. The first Sweet Tango really began hitting the market in 2009. That was our first shot at commercialization of, one of these, and it was one of the first managed, what they call managed varieties within the apple category. So it's kind of a experiment that has led to a lot of other varieties coming on the market and really being a benefit for consumers. But we've got growers in New York and Minnesota, Michigan, Wisconsin, Canada, and Washington. So we're really, nationwide. Yeah,
I mean, it's everywhere. That's really all of the primary growing regions.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And the growers are really handpicked and, by the gentleman who started NBT and very wonderful commercial growers of apples. And we also have, a group of growers who actually have the farm markets. And that's, I think you're referring to episode 168 was Pine Tree, where you can go out and get Sweet Tango freshly picked off the tree.
And that's exactly it. Yes.
Yep. So it's amazing, and they are resilient, and so you have to be resilient if it takes 20 years to develop a product and then get it to the market and to consumers' mouths.
Isn't that amazing? I mean, how do people think? Yeah, I'm gonna this. I mean, people have no idea that this one apple variety has so much preparation behind bring it to market, literally, to your point, 2 decades. It's unbelievable. Every time I hear that statistic, I have to highlight it because it blows my mind each and every time I hear it.
Oh yeah. I mean, you talk about, you think about like Lay's potato chips, and they come on the market with these, different flavors, and that takes about 18 months usually. And, you talk about apple growers and innovation, and it's like, they are the mad scientist of innovation in the produce area, really. I truly believe that.
Yeah. Yeah. It takes a lot to make sure you have the right cultivar and the right climate, the right growers. I mean, so much goes into it, but let's talk about the eating experience, because I really think, yes, the grower network, of course, is a point of differentiation, like I said, but what gets people coming back to Sweet Tango is the taste. It 100% is why I think we all go back to whatever foods we're, whatever foods we consider our favorites. But with the Sweet Tango, the taste is really where the story is at. So Jen, I'd love to get your remarks on what the Sweet Tango apple tastes like.
There's really, and it's not passé. It's funny. I am partial, but I'm not partial. There is really nothing like a Sweet Tango. And I like to tell a story. I have a friend who's been in the produce industry for over 50 years, and I took the apple to him at one of the conferences we were at, and I handed it to him, and he took one bite, and he's like, "Oh, it's a Honeycrisp." And he stopped for a minute, and he's like, "No, it's not a Honeycrisp." And he knew it was different. He knew it was special. And as he's sitting there and crunching and juice is just, flowing down his mouth, and he's talking with his mouth full, and he's like, "Jen, what is this? I have to have more." I told him it was a Sweet Tango, and that's really, it's such a pleasure to represent a product that has that effect on people who have been in an industry for almost their entire lives. And it is the taste, and it's, we have a jingle, and it's Sweet Tango apples so good they make you smile. And it's true. You take a bite of a Sweet Tango and you can't do anything but smile, because it is almost like a sinful bite of something that is so, so good. And I think you described it, the crunch is there, the juiciness is there, but once you start going through the complexity of the flavor of a Sweet Tango, it's just amazing. It does it. We like to say it has a little bit of spice and citrus and honey.
Yeah.
And it's like really complex.
You're right. It is. It's like this, it's almost like a natural cinnamon, and to your point, a little zesty with the snap of a lemon or something real bright, but then it's got the warmth of like the spice. It is a complex apple, but it hits on all the senses for sure. And it's beautiful on the outside. I mean, it's a bicolor apple, which is what the majority of apples are, especially within this managed variety sector. We should probably define that, Jen. I don't think, you know, we can't assume that everyone with us today even knows what managed variety means, but I'll do how I would explain it first, or my definition first, and then please clarify. And if you feel like we need to, but managed varieties are what we would consider your branded apples. Okay. You've got your legacy varieties, which are, Red Delicious, Galas, Fuji's, Honeycrisp. Those are legacy varieties. It means that they're going to be grown by pretty much everyone in the apple business is growing those. And usually those apples are, you know, you'll see a lot of them in bags and, you know, they're kind of just like staples or classics within the apple category. And then you've got what we call managed variety. Those are actually your branded apples. Those are apples that are, you know, in the world of apples, more often than not, these are the newer varieties. These are varieties, to Jen's point, that have been a lot of times, cross pollination of varieties that are, heirlooms or legacy varieties. And they bring distinct characteristics into the market that serve all the stakeholders. These managed varieties are very grower friendly. They are retailer friendly and they are household friendly or consumer friendly. So they have the taste, they have the durability, they can store well, they are sustainable for the farming economy. The premium apples, they can get a premium price. Those are all ways that I would describe managed variety. But Jen, anything you want to add to that?
Yeah, I think, you know, managed varieties are something that give consumers a fresher look at the categories that they love. So, you know, you see grapes and you see cotton candy grapes, and they're just developments within that category that help a consumer get even closer to the flavor and crunch profile that they're looking for. And a lot of our growers grow those based on time periods. So you won't see these apples, to your point, Lori, in stores for the entire season like you would a Gala or a Fuji. They're available for a very short time, which makes them pretty valuable. And we're having Sweet Tango available for longer and longer because, you know, my growers see how valuable this variety is, and to our fans, you know, once you're a fan of Sweet Tango, you never want to go to a different apple. But yeah, I think that's a good way to put it. And you know, the Galas and the Fujis and the Honeycrisps are there always in the markets, but you're going to see that you'll always be able to have apples, but you know, the managed varieties will be there at certain times of the year, and you'll be able to have a little bit different taste and experience throughout the season because of managed varieties.
Yep. Wonderful. Well, thank you for explaining that for everyone. Let's get into the growing practices and social responsibility, because the taste is obviously paramount in importance, but really consumer data insights and the industry's interest in being a sustainable producer is very important. It's rising in importance and relevancy each and every day. So talk a little bit more about the Sweet Tango growing practices and social responsibility programs.
Yeah, so we're, you know, because we have Sweet Tangos grown nationwide, we really try to stick to a carbon footprint sustainability play with Sweet Tango, just to keep, you know, those apples within those regions. Of course, you're going to see apples from Washington and New York and that type of thing. But where we can, we try to keep apples that are grown in a particular growing region within that growing region, just to help with that carbon footprint. But the growers of Sweet Tango are, you know, Sweet Tango is such a valuable variety that they do things like shade netting and hail netting just to protect them. To get them to their perfect color, they put Mylar film on the ground and use that to color the apples. And so you know, we're looking at even possibly moving to a more sustainable packaging in the next couple of years, just to kind of cut down on that plastic play for the bags. But, you know, I think all my growers really are cognizant about water usage, you know, usage of you know, artificial means to do anything but, you know, keep the apple pristine, and anything like that. So it's very important to us to be good stewards of the land and be able to have land, a farm, and for generations to come. And if you don't do that, you really find that there's not sustainability, you know, past it. So I think, you know, that's kind of the long and short of it. Most commercial apple growers are very cognizant of, you know, their planting schedules, how many apples they plant on an acre of land. You know, all those things go into consideration, water usage, you know, just kind of keeping that to that sustainability play is to keep apples for years to come.
Yeah, absolutely. So important. And I love that you brought that up, because it's a component of sustainability that maybe people don't always think about. You know, it's sustainability is definitely some of the more common things that are top of mind, like water usage, recycling, carbon footprint, to your point. But what is sustainability if you're not in business season after season?
Yeah, that's important. And if you don't have the soil to grow, you know, soil is such a important component in any kind of farming. Mm-hmm. And if you just drain the nutrients from the ground and don't replace them and don't do, you know, sustainable practices for it, you know, keeping the land producing, it's just, it won't keep you in business.
Right. Correct. Definitely. Well, let's talk about, you know, how all apples are not created equally and why you have such pride in supporting this branded apple at Sweet Tango. I mean, why do you think it's important for households and moms like me to have access to branded apples and the Sweet Tango?
You know, I think what I love about innovation within the apple category is really any consumer can find the exact taste that they're looking for. And that's really what a managed variety does. And, you know, I don't know that all consumers speak the same language as we do with fracture and, you know, sugars and starches and that type of thing. But there's a lot of people who know exactly what they like, but they don't know how to, you know, put it into terms. And so I think that's what the managed variety does is, you know, especially with apples. Apples are such a healthy fruit with, you know, their fiber content. And, you know, it's such, and you and I have talked about it, Lori, is it's kind of a sinful thing, but it's so good for you. And no mom is going to get upset about giving their child two apples, you know, two candy bars, maybe, but two apples, you want a second apple? Sure. So I think that's what managed varieties do, is it expands the likelihood that consumers will come back to the apple category. And I think that's what's so important about, you know, your mission as the produce moms and, you know, what you guys are trying to do is get people eating more healthy products, you know, keep our farmers in business and, you know, keep those innovations a part of the future. And I think that's really what a managed variety does. And you can find really, you know, hard, dense, very, very sweet apples, very crunchy apples, you know, sweet tart apples that are great for baking or, you know, use in cocktails. So I think that's, you know, what it lends is it really gets us to another section of the consumer groups that will keep fans for years to come.
Yeah, absolutely. So I'm sure we've turned some people into Sweet Tango fans at this point, Jen, right? There's undoubtedly people who are thinking, okay, where do I go and get one of these amazing apples? But I'd love for you to answer that question. Where can people find Sweet Tango apples?
So one of the things that we developed last year, and we put on our website, it's www.sweettango, and it's only one T, so sweettango.com, is a product locator. And so Any consumer can go on there and input their zip code and see the markets around them that are selling Sweet Tango. So, you know, we have very good partnerships with Walmart and Trader Joe's and Aldi and Costco and Kroger and a lot of the main, you know, grocery stores. You know, I think that's probably the best way to find a Sweet Tango is if you go to that website and look for that product locator. It's at the top right corner. But the other, you know, the other way to do it is, you know, we kind of laugh is follow Sweet Tango on social media. So we've got a Facebook page, a Insta page, and Pinterest. And our Sweet Tango fans are so wonderful that, you know, if somebody says, I can't find Sweet Tango anywhere, our fans will hit them back with a response, you know, in that area that they found Sweet Tango at this particular market. And that's what's so magical about this apple is people want other people to try it. And it's such a gift to the other person to pay it forward and that you'll see them on social media, which is pretty spectacular when it comes to a brand.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. If you've got people following along with your apple social media, I'd say you're doing it right. You know, so you're doing a great job, and you're right. All of the people that are part of these social followings, they are ultimate ambassadors for what you're doing at Sweet Tango. And just definitely want to call out to folks, please do check them out on social. And to Jen's point, Sweet Tango is spelled SweetTango. So only one T there. So sweettango.com, and on all social handles, you can find them. Well, Jen, with that, we're pretty much at the end of the show here. It's been such a wonderful discussion, but like all of our shows, we don't end without our guests getting the final thoughts and the closing remarks. So, you know, I'm certainly thankful for you, and we love promoting Sweet Tango. It's been absolutely, just an absolute blast and a blessing at the same time to support your growers and work hand in hand with you to promote this wonderful apple that just tastes so good that we all love and believe in. So, thank you for being our guest today and all that you do. We look forward to supporting Sweet Tango, you know, really year round, and definitely right now is the heart and soul of this season, and we are here for it. And Jen, any closing remarks that you have and final goodbye, please?
Yeah. So I would just say, I would put out what I call the Apple Challenge. And this is to all your moms, is to do a fun activity with the kids and go to your local grocery store. And even if Sweet Tango or any of these other varieties aren't available, just pick up one variety of each different apple in the store, and take it home and do a fun activity with your kids and try it. You know, try each apple and get their thoughts on what they think about the taste, and just see how different each of these apples and each of the bites are. And it'll really open your eyes. And I really think that, you know, just as an ambassador of the apple industry, I think that's just a fun activity that will kind of create engagement and education with families and friends, and just kind of keep serving our apple consumers in years to come. So thank you so much for having me and supporting Sweet Tango, Lori. I've enjoyed every minute that we've been a part of your partnership.
Thanks for joining us on this episode of the Produce Moms Podcast. If you or someone you know would like to be a featured guest, just send an email to Lori@theproducemoms.com. We know there is a produce mom in you because there's a produce mom in all of us. Join our community on Facebook and all social platforms. Help us change the way America eats. Thanks again for listening, and we'll see you next time.